sacred site. Showed the back here, and I guess a little bit of local history. There's a crockery tree just over in the back parklands here, which we believe is about 300 to 500 years sort of old, somewhere in that vicinity. And for us at Cricket Victoria, we really, really highly respectful of the fact that we're on some pretty important land, and as a result, we were really fortunate to be right behind our Victorian or the Australian Indigenous team that travelled to England this year, and we had a number of players from Victoria representing Victoria, Australia in that. So as a way of acknowledgement and welcome to you all, I'd like to thank you up front on behalf of Cricket Victoria's board. We're really proud of the Cricket community and the work that everyone does to support this great game. I'm a passionate cricket person, as a number of you who I know will attest to, and it's a really, really important role that everyone plays in supporting local cricket. Before I introduce our keynote speaker, just wanted to touch on a couple of initiatives that are happening up front. This week there was an announcement of investment in community cricket by Cricket Australia. So a total of $35 million over the next 3 years into community cricket. It's a great time, I guess, to be exploring opportunities, particularly in infrastructure. About $12 million will be invested in infrastructure, and Victoria, we hope, will play a really key part in that. The other part which Paul Woolworths noted was the Woolworths Cricket Blast. So the investment into that particular program is the old Milo, the Cricket Milo T20 Blast, now being Woolworths Cricket Blast. That now enables clubs to really generate not only the players and provide for the community, but also to get rewarded financially through the model that's been set up, as opposed to all the funds coming back up through Cricket Australia and Cricket Victoria. So I encourage you to have a really good look and explore at that particular program, and to ensure that your club is ready and raring for all the kids that are going to be knocking down the door to play at your club this year. I guess finally, before I introduce Peter Downs from Play By The Rules for the keynote speech, I'd like to acknowledge that this forum is I guess put on for you, and as a result we're really keen to make sure that it hits the mark. So please, over the course of the day, we're really interested in the feedback to make sure that the future forums can really align with your needs as Cricket Club volunteers. So it is for you, and we hope that it achieves the aim of being informative, thought-provoking, and provides you with a really good leg up for the season. Whether that be you're a first-year committee person, or whether you're an established person on the committee who's just looking at some opportunity to stay ahead of the curve. So without further ado, I'd like to acknowledge and welcome Peter, who has come down from Sydney for this event. And he's an amazing person in terms of his background with Play By The Rules and the work he's done there. So I think it'll be a really interesting keynote speech. So Peter, welcome aboard and thank you.
Thanks, Robin, and thanks, Josh, and Cricket Victoria for inviting me here. I was just thinking that it's very nice to be able to present and work with a sport I kind of love and a background in myself. I get quite a few invitations and opportunities to speak. A few weeks ago, I was with Pony Clubs Australia. To be honest, I haven't a clue anything about pony clubs, and it's a real struggle sometimes to talk about this stuff without knowing the context of where you're from. I played cricket for many, many years in the UK before coming out here in 26 years ago now, and I reached the dizzy heights of Canberra second grade before the bat and the shoulder going out on me a number of years ago now. So I really love cricket, my first love of sport, so I can relate to where you come from here. Now, what I'm going to talk about though is around integrity issues in sport at community level. Now, do you know, I don't know if you know, that there was recently a show of hands, who's aware of that review that was conducted into the integrity of sport nationally just recently? Okay, so probably not even a quarter, perhaps. Don't worry, it's, it wasn't exactly headline news, but it was a review into the integrity of sport driven by Lord Chief Justice James Wood QC and an eminent panel who over a number of months conducted this review into the integrity of sport. And the funny thing is they asked, play by the rules, to have input into that process. And play by the rules is a mixture of different organisations and jurisdictions. And I said to them, well, I can't really talk on behalf of all the different partners of play by the rules, and they'll all, anyway, have their input into the integrity of themselves as well. But they came back to me and they said, no, Peter, we'd actually like your input into the review from your perspective as manager, hearing about these issues on a day-to-day basis in your role and my background in that area. I was a bit flattered by that. I thought, yeah, fine, okay. And they arranged for a time to call me in the morning. They were going to give me a call. And I thought this would be from the secretariat of the integrity review rather than the panel itself. And so it was scheduled for 9 o'clock some Wednesday morning. And at 8 o'clock, the phone goes. I'm sitting on my kitchen bench at home, just finishing my primary reporting at ABC Breakfast News. And the phone goes and it says, hello, this is James Wood. Thanks for taking our call. And I'm going, who's James Wood? I don't know James Wood. Who's this? And he says, oh, I've got the panel. Put you on speakerphone. We've got the panel here. I'm going, I think that's it. It's a Lord Chief Justice James Wood, QC, who did the report to the corruption in foreign police and that kind of thing. Anyway, I calmed down and I thought, okay, yeah, okay. I haven't got my notes with me because I think there's a time difference between when we arranged it and where I was sitting, which I didn't take into account for, so they pulled me off guard a bit. So I finished with sort of eating the porridge, turned the TV off and said, it was fine. What I wanted to talk about, though, with the panel was integrity at a grassroots community level isn't about anti-doping, isn't about match fixing or corruption or illegal wagering, which is primarily what the report talks about. If you have got a life like me outside of work and your interest, then you might want to read their report. It's over 200 pages long, 52 recommendations. Primarily concerned with anti-doping, match-fixing, and corruption issues. Now, no denying they are a threat to sport, absolutely, totally, and some of those certainly have an impact on community sport, no doubt about it, and it's going to be happening. Right? I can talk to you about that. But those are not the issues that impact on the integrity of sport. What I see on a day-to-day basis. Yesterday, I had inquiries around a violent incident at a tennis club in Victoria. 2 days before that, there was a harassment and bullying complaint at a bowls club in Sydney. A day before that, it was another harassment and discrimination one in dragon boating. And also, it's been a week before, there's pony clubs again. Those ponies, totally going off the charts. But these issues of community sport range from child safety, very serious child safety type issues, to corruption in terms of treasurers running embezzling funds, to harassment, discrimination, bullying type issues at a community level. And they impact on the integrity of the sport, no question. Now, if you get a bit of a Google search and look at what integrity means, you'll come up with all kinds of things. There's no standard definition, not even the National Integrity Sport Unit has a standard definition. But if I asked you now, the two common things would be trust and honesty. That those two words would definitely be in your understanding, everybody's understanding about what integrity means. So if there's harassment and discrimination issue at a community club, that impacts on the trust and honesty of that club and their image of that club. So how does, apart from the rules and regulations, how does the club deal with those type of issues? About a year or so ago, I was asked to do a presentation for the Australian New Zealand Sports Law Association. And I thought it would be interesting. They wanted to know the prevalence of issues that are occurring at a grassroots level. There isn't any, as far as I can find, research around that really. But I've got a bit of an insight. When I get an inquiry, like the ones that I make, what I tend to do is try and deal with them the best I can in terms of referring them to resources that are available. We don't offer a counselling service for that, but I can certainly refer them to plenty of resources that we have and that others have around those issues. And then I colour code them and archive them under different categories of that issue so that I can look back at that archive and tell how many I'm getting in a certain area, say bullying or harassment. So I can look back in time and I've archived all those under different colour codes that I have. So I did a bit of analysis for ANZLA, and this is the reverse order of that list of issues that come into play by the rules. About 20% of issues generally were around discrimination-based issues in sport, which out of about 550 different inquiries, that's about 20%. But broadly, out of those, just for your interest, right, it wasn't much difference, but between race discrimination, discrimination based on sexuality, and disability discrimination, was certainly the top three there. But it was pretty constant. Second place in the popularity of issues that come in to play by the rules was selection based issues. I'm surprised it wasn't actually higher than that, to be honest. But these are disputes based more on selection-based disputes than anything else. Sometimes I've seen a trend, just in the last year or so, for those selection-based issues. If parties don't get their way in the outcome, that sometimes they don't even know what the outcome they're actually looking for is, then the discrimination part of that comes into play. But often it comes down to the selection is is due to a discrimination issue rather than a selection policy issue. And if that makes sense. So I've seen that kind of thing happen quite a bit. But in first place, double anything else, I reckon it's been this way to play by the rules since it started over a dozen years ago, was behaviour, sideline behaviour, mostly at junior school type issue. So parents going off on the sideline. Coaches abusing players, all kinds of issues from the sidelines, primarily but not only at junior school type issue. And it goes across the board. There is no sport, even tiny clubs, even BMX, even though sport tennis, all the sports have issues around this issue, and they affect the integrity of the sport. No question about that. In the last couple of years in Canberra, Ireland, we've had two rounds of junior sport football played behind closed doors where no one's allowed in because of spectator behaviour issues. Only the players and the coaches and staff, it's incredible, isn't it? Only the players, coaches and staff are allowed in to watch those games. Happened twice in one season because of the behaviour of the sideline. And these impact on the integrity of sport big time. Unfortunately, the Wood Review doesn't really address any of that. It's really around the higher level issues around anti-doping, match fixing, corruption. So way before the Wood Review came in, this had been recognised by, these sorts of issues been recognised by the Play by the Rules Network in particular, who, like me, see them quite often. So can we develop, look at a tool to help people in community sport that is above and beyond the guidelines and codes of conduct and the tools that we already have, which the cricket's well equipped with, that can help everybody rather than just the complaint handler or the president or the committee or the member protection information officer, for example. These can help, this kind of tool can help everybody deal with these kinds of issues. So, to cut a long story short, we came up with this tool, worked for probably 18 months or so, trialed it. It's now a tool being used by ASADA for anti-doping, for National Team Sport Unit, and for various sports as well. But I think it's a really useful one to go through. We're going to do that in a second. to go through with you to see how you can, every one of you, can use this kind of tool in a way to help you address these issues. It's called the Get Forward Decision Making Framework, which I think you've got a copy of there. Now, the Get Forward Decision Making Framework is really pretty simple. Traditionally, what happens, and I see this a lot, is that complaint handling processes are governed primarily by the codes and regulations that we already have in place. So there'll be somebody in the club, probably a number of people, large clubs, who have pretty got their head all around this, got to understand what the complaint handling process is. But it's reactive, isn't it? That's reactive to when something happens. It's not being proactive at the time. And very, very often, issues can get out of hand very quickly, particularly if they're not handled really well. So this is a framework that you can kind of cement in your mind. You don't need to carry it around with you, but it's pretty straightforward once you get it. But it really helps in terms of understanding not just your club's position, but yours as well, in terms of ethical decision-making and what might happen. I'm going to run through a quick example, and we're going to test a couple as well with yourself to run through that. Now, this is one that I've used for multiple sports, even use it for pony clubs, which could be that I can relate to. I'm sure you'll see and understand where I'm coming from here. And we're going to run through the ethical decision-making framework and apply it to this context. Let's have a look.
To the end, guys, what else is the umpire? He's walking, he's walking. Wow, there we are. That's a great to see. We thought there might be some bat down at this stage, but up the ball went, and then probably off the glove. Now, it might have been a bit of ease. It was nicely taken, Sakakara moving quickly. He was saved, no doubt.
What are the facts? First part of the framework asks what are the facts behind what happened here? What do we know? Not only about the actual incident you've just seen right there, but there's facts around it that contribute to what happens next. What do we know?
We know the players involved.
We know the players involved. We know who the captain was at that time and what his policy kind of was.
It was the semi-final of the World Cup.
Yeah, semi-final of the World Cup, big game. Semi-final of the World Cup, big player, Gilchrist. We know he's a facts.
We know the
umpire's
decision.
We know the umpire's decision, yes. Oh yeah. We know there was a crowd, big crowd there watching, millions on TV probably. Okay, what do we know then about values and ethics around this? Let's take it on an individual and a team level. What are Gilchrist's values and ethics here, which are obviously, clearly, extremely strong? Eight sides of the wall. Semi-final, World Cup, millions watching, given not out, he decides to walk against team policy, really, about unwritten policy. Hunting said, we don't do that. His values were so strong that he was prepared to do that there and override everything else. But what about rules and regulations? What do we know about rules and regulations?
You don't have to walk.
You don't have to yet. Made his own rule about this. This is his rule, his ethic. He's allowed to do that, he's not against the rules. But you see the grey area that's even something seemingly as simple as this caused the big dry area. And Gilchrist has kind of made a career out of it post the sport. What else is a factor that's different from this kind of incident happening where you are? And does it matter?
Sets a standard.
Yeah, it sets a standard for sure. Absolutely.
Yeah, well, it's just on TV, but you can see it. You can play it.
Yeah, it's on TV, of course, lots of bikes. Does that make a difference? If this happened locally, trying to get, does it make a difference that millions are watching the semi-final World Cup?
It's not so much the difference you get to see, but when it happens out on the...
Yeah, that's true.
You can see it. Whereas when it's happened out in real life, you can't play it.
Does it make a difference, Harry? Kind of doesn't, but does, you know, really, it's a tricky one when you think about it. Because it happened locally, you're right, a few people see it, and the world aren't watching it, it's not the same part of the World Cup. Gilchrist isn't your best player and your last game or whatever. But does that matter? These are the kind of issues that, you know, even locally, it might be something fine about the competition, it might be a bit more important than that. They have an impact.
We don't always have umpires.
That's
umpires. Umpires take months.
Yeah.
So it does make that.
Yeah. And when you say it sets the standard, that's a kind of interesting one, because Ponting had already set the standard, made it very clear that's not our policy. Because I think he knew that's what was going to happen if this situation occurred. He knew that people were just blocking forward. So you see the interesting in all sorts of factors. Last part of the ethical decision-making framework is around making about what you do next. Now, I can't remember, I should have looked it up, what was said, well, there was a lot said after this, of course, Lucas made a career in it, but immediately after this incident, Tony Gray says, isn't that great? I'm sure probably Ian Chappell might not have thought so. And other commentators may not have thought so.
I'm sure Tony Gray wouldn't have thought so if it was his teammates.
Yeah,
when
he might, maybe, you reckon? Craig would? No, I don't think, well, but you know, there's all sorts of things that come into that ethical decision making what actually occurs next. Yeah. You can apply this framework to all kinds of situations. Let's have a look at the next one quickly. I'm sure you have.
When Australia's frustration turned to anger.
Yeah! Oh, delivery, and he's still there, Stuart Moore. What's he standing there for? They're all appealed. It looks as if he just did tick to the keeper. Oh my goodness, speechless. The audacity of he just walked up the pitch, in other words, with his non-striking matter.
With no reviews at his disposal, the skipper let fly.
So, excellent decision making. Framework, what were the kind of rules and regulations around this? Same as before, really. No different to what we just saw. What about personal values and ethics and team ethics? It's different. It's just the opposite of what Gilchrist did, but so blatantly obvious. Does it make a difference that it's obvious, as opposed to being subtle? It shouldn't do, but it does, doesn't it? It does actually make a difference how obvious it was, because Broad was smashed for this. Yeah, he may well have got a feather on it and been caught behind and a bit of a down there, so what, he can't walk in. Same thing. You see the difference in context is really important in terms of all this kind of decision making stuff. And yeah, it wasn't killed because he was such an obvious nick, but he was because but you know, it's different. So when the rules and regulations also around this are exactly the same as the previous, the truth about it, quite supportive, obviously very supportive of him afterwards, like, yeah, well, that's what, you know, it's up to the decision, we haven't broken any rules, they might even give out, so it's not out. So why are we kind of walk? But is it really different? You know, your personal values there, is it different as a spectator? Don't know, I'll leave it with you, maybe it is. again, what's the decision, the codes and the rules around this, and what's the decision that can be made afterwards as well? Let's translate that now to this is obviously the impact of international games and TV. It does have an impact on that kind of thing. But let's translate that now to a local say to local scenarios that you may encounter. Let's have a look at this one. It's getting close to the end of the season, and the club's 7-11, there's a tight race between two players to win the club's batting record. One of these players also enters and scores into my cricket. Some members of the club noticed the players' runs scored in my cricket doesn't actually reflect what he's written in the scorebook. How does the club handle this situation? So go back to I read the one that's but I've got the two screen thing. You can see it there. So what happens in this situation? It's part of the ethical decision making framework to this. What are the rules and other rules and regulations? So unwritten, not just what's written, that's quite important. There are some unwritten kind of rules and ethics around it too. And these need to be considered in the situation too. What are the rules and codes that may impact on what might be meant to this?
Don't trust my
Give him a small trade.
Are there any rules and regulations around this? Are there actually written codes?
Depends on the club.
Yeah.
Depends on whether the club takes the scorebook as the correct figure or the night grid. So it's a club rule.
What is it, a rule? Or is it just the way
a club line?
Yeah, okay.
What about the super solution? Is it a data entry issue?
Sorry?
What about the first question? Is it a data entry issue or is it deliberate?
Correct. Yeah, well, is it a data entry issue? And the three fingers, not two, or something?
So you have to check the other team's score when you start.
That's going to have a bearing on the decision you make about what to do next,
yep.
Isn't it? The opposition club has the right to contact the association and lodge a complaint with that.
I see quite often in play by the rules that because of the way we all kind of work, because we're actually really well supported with rules, regulations, codes of conduct, and protection policies, we're really pretty quick, especially a lot of sports, very familiar with all that process, and there tends to be a really default mechanism to go back straight to that without a formal kind of process, whereas issues can be addressed informally. People tend to default to, what do the rules say? What do the codes say? Let's apply that. And it just keeps opening across the rocks people's back and fix a lot of problems in that way. Whereas what we're trying to promote is informal handling of the situation. This is a good example of where it could be. What about ethics and values here as well? Because it's representing the club as well as yourself.
But the other thing is, you'd like to be that a club allows players to bring the game to be entering their own data.
Yes. Does that give a data cluster sheet?
But it should be set up as a policy error anyway. If there's been players in their scoring, you shouldn't let one of them handle this data entry.
Yeah.
Should be someone else appointed.
Certainly, if it wasn't before, this could give rise to. I think someone could be appointed to do that.
Yep.
Certainly an independent person, people are entering their own. I think that's, again,
you've got someone with ethics, they're going to change their own sport, you don't want them in your club doing them. Because if they're likely to change their own sport, they're not looking at them. They're just fine. If they've got the integrity to be able to change their score to win, win something, why would you want them to be in charge of anything?
And that's the integrity of sport. Spot on that. It does. It affects the whole club. So when someone does that as an individual, it does impact on the whole club. And I think again, I see that fairly often too, that often clubs will dissociate themselves very quickly from issues like this, whereas it's a reflection of the club, so the club being kind of a moment. But decisions about what to do next have already come up with a couple. What kind of decisions could be made? Is the whole point of this decision-making framework is to get to a point where you can consider the rules, regulations, the facts behind this. Are there any facts from what's described here? Always, initially about a complaint, the claim is given that 100% of the time you don't know all the facts. So if you're a complaint officer, I'm sure NGIOs or complaint officers here would understand that straight away you don't know. You might be told a lot of things, but you certainly don't know all the facts. There's more to consider in any given situation. So, are there any other facts that could be missing from this scenario?
Whether it was a statement or not.
Whether it was just in the near simple statement or not. Yes. And you have to think about that. That was the main one of the current thing, whether it was just an innocent mistake or not. So it needs to be addressed informally that way. But hey, look, what's going on here? Yeah, good. ultimate, okay, what rules and regulations might apply?
But not the umpire's
decision. Yeah, totally, yeah, the umpire has to make a decision. He can't be the fielder, no matter what angle the team players make a decision. It has to be the umpire. It's some way. Can you see a problem there?
Yes. If it's self-umpired, the umpire's in the batting, then what's wrong?
Sorry?
If it's self-umpired, the umpire's come from the batting team. So it's in his positive.
Yeah,
sport.
Yeah, and not neutral.
No, you could actually make it, who's umpiring, you'd say, well, it's got to be given as a 9-4 if they're the umpire. And that would be fair to say, no, not going to happen.
Yeah, but you also might have, like, I know you've asked at times, when you get to a lot of grades, you might have, like, kids umpiring. And so there's an intimidation factor there as well. From a batsman and you know, the older gentleman, for instance, because this has happened a few times with us, and he's literally still over the kid, he's on fire, you know, it was four, right? And the kid's just gone, yeah.
That's another integrity issue.
Yeah. But it's a really good, one because I see that in other sports too. There's nearly always some kind of power imbalance between conflict. And that's a real, real issue with ethical decision making. It's a real difficult. Even in a fairly easy situation like this, it still can be. It could be, like, it doesn't say, it could be a child without adult.
Is there not rules about how old the umpires can be? You can't have under 18 umpires.
Yeah, there may be some rules and regulations.
Is that a big child safety issue then as well?
Yeah.
I was going to say, when someone does some umpiring in junior cricket, this incident happens where parents sit. Typically, I'd say 70% of people are good, and as an umpire, I'll take the collective view. Like, you might see through this, but I don't think everyone pretends a bad egg. The majority of the parents in junior cricket, I think, do the right thing, even across their son or daughter of the game.
It's an interesting one. Would they take any notice of if there are spectators or parents who are spectators on the side?
I personally think guided by the parents rather than the kids. I think kids have got a more creative interpretation of it.
What if it's a quite a serious adult game? Before,
And it also might happen on the other side of the ground where parents aren't sitting, so literally I'll make a official call.
Yeah. This is a dilemma, gentle dilemma, for an umpire, is it?
Doesn't it come back at the start of the game when you toss? The two captains will agree that, you know, will take the honesty of the fielder that's going to the boundary. If you haven't got paid umpires, it becomes very, very difficult. So you've got to rely on the honesty of that fieldsman.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
a close to that.
Yeah. Okay. About the decision, see how it kind of helps whoever's in the situation. So what are the rules and regulations that might dictate here? Are there any things like this? Sometimes it's unwritten rules and regulations, values and behaviours that are expected. Because in this, it's certainly cricket, it's a massive sport, and that, this would be one example of that. What are the facts that we know and that influence that? As we've seen, it's not always as clear-cut as you might think. There are facts that sit behind all issues that have a circumstance to it as well. Your personal ethics and values have an influence. People often dissociate from that, but it's actually important. That's one of the reasons behind this whole framework we developed. And there's a lot of discussion around how you incorporate personal ethics and values in this, which are important and often dictate how people behave. And then the values and ethics of team and club and organisation as well. We see ISIC conflict quite a bit between personal ethics and values and ethics and values of organisation. So sometimes really, really strong differences. There might be quite little differences between what you believe in and personally and what the club might believe in. But sometimes you see really strong differences, and that's where conflict can be really quite difficult. So at least understanding that, using a framework like this, helps understand those kind of differences. Okay, my values are different. They could be based on all kinds of things. You're religious values, for example, could be part of all that. So the bottom line is about respecting and understanding those, and this is the framework helps at least identify those designs. Helps them come to a decision. You've got more ability then to come to a more random decision that takes in the rules and regulations, takes in the facts of what's happened in a broader sense, and the values and ethics of yourself and your club and organisation and team at the same time. All these are factors trying to get some kind of resolution. Try some out in your own club. Try some of these sorts of scenarios, and you can see these are very common. I'm sure you can think of plenty of others that you can test out in your own club. It's a really useful exercise, and I've certainly done it with a number of sport-specific organisations and clubs, and all kinds of issues come out. But the framework just helps that line of thinking that everyone kind of thinking in the same sort of way. Don't default to codes and practices and member protection policies and rules and regulations, because they can't cover every scenario. They can't cover personal ethics and values and things like that. They can cover process, not all these other things. So that's why, that's one of the reasons why this framework was developed. You haven't done that one? Okay. The framework and scenarios, presentations, and information more around this are on Play by the Rules. Hopefully you're familiar with playbytherules.net.au. You can go to there and download totally for free. And please do contact me as well about any of this kind of stuff, because it's a regular thing that you might do. Hope that helps in some way. Good, so keep that in mind. We've got the ethical decision making framework. There's a resource for Play by the Rules behind it. And we should all do the very best. But I'm happy to.